Oh, So glad to see you today. This is the last lecture of the quarter on CS202. And sometimes I do hope that, when I have a lecture, I can be in a concert hall, in an auditorium, like what the music clip just showed, right? So hopefully one day some of you can donate a lot of money so that I can teach a class like that in an auditorium. But before that, right, it's very important that you have those system design concepts in mind and also know all the important details, all the important perspectives regarding all aspects about operating systems. So that may give you some kind of idea about what to do in the future. So the last concept we are going to talk about is virtual machines. And today we are going to have some reflections on what we have learned throughout this quarter using a paper, The Hints of Computer System Design. But before we start, it's always a good idea to remind you where we are coming from. So at the end of the last lecture, we talk about the very last concept that we are going to talk about in this class is virtual machines. So you learned before that we have many, many different types of virtualization. And throughout the first half of the quarter, we were talking about the process virtualization. And then now we are going to talk about system virtualization. And we are especially focusing on the case of virtual machines in a way that we are creating a virtual machine that can host the whole operating system on the same type of instruction set architecture. So that's the type of stuff that we are focusing on. And there are two types of virtual machine architecture can fulfill that goal. One is the host virtual, let me see if this is the best slide. Okay, so there are two types of architecture can help us accomplish that goal. One is a hosted virtual machine. So the basic concept of hosted virtual machine is that on top of an existing operating system, we run the virtual machine monitor and you run your guest operating system and applications on top of the virtual machine monitor. So when you are doing your project, the VMware workstation or the VirtualBox is using this type of virtual machine. And another type of virtual machine monitor that we have is that we don't have an operating system under the virtual machine monitor. Instead, you just have the virtual machine monitor directly interact with your bare machine. So you can imagine in this way, your virtual machine monitor is working closer to your hardware. So the overhead is definitely lower. However, there are definitely some kind of a drawback of that, which we will talk about this kind of architecture. So, but no matter what type of virtual machine monitor that you are using, there are three guidelines that we care about. The first type of guideline is fidelity, means that the virtual machine environment should provide an identical perspective as the original machine. So any software, including your operating system running on top of the virtual machine, should not feel any difference. Compare against of running this on a bare machine. And the thing is that, we want good performance out of it. So even though you are running a virtual machine, you don't want any significant performance degradation. And finally, the reason why we want virtual machine is because we want to get the benefit of virtualization, meaning that each virtualized machine is a container itself. It isolates the virtual machine with one another, and different virtual machines should not intervene each other. So you can have safety and isolation. And how to achieve a virtual machine? There are several different ways. There are three main ideas to implement a virtual machine. The first thing is deprivileging, and the second thing is primary and shadow structures, and the last thing is tracing. So we were talking about deprivileging in the last lecture. So the basic idea of deprivileging is that originally your operating system should be running in a privileged mode. However, because you have the virtual machine monitor, so instead of having your operating system run in a privileged mode, it becomes your virtual machine monitor running in a privileged mode. So your operating system is now in a deprivileged mode. So in this case, right, when we want to have a system call, what it turns out is that, well, if it's unprivileged instruction, it's still the same. You run those instructions directly on the machine. And if it's a system call, well, because it's a privileged mode. So this system call will go to the privileged mode software, which is the kernel code for the virtual machine monitor. And the virtual machine monitor would handle and update the virtualized machine status and mainly the virtualized CPU status. And after it performs the corresponding operations, it traps into the guest operating system, which is your original operating system, and call the corresponding handler to handle this system call. However, if in the middle of the handler, there's any privileged instruction being used, then the virtual machine monitor again will have to handle those vCPU status. So as you can imagine, the overhead of this kind of architecture is that whenever you have a system call and whenever you have a privileged instruction, the additional overhead coming from the fact that the virtual machine monitor has to additionally handle and update those CPU status instead of originally the guest operating system can directly execute those privileged instructions. And because those vCPUs are software emulated, so somehow you will spend more instruction to update those data structures correctly, right? And after your guest operating system finish this trap handler, your software can finally your operating system can finally return to your calling application. So on the application side, there's nothing need to be changed. It still does its own system call. You still have to return. On the guest operating system side, because when you issue the privileged instruction, it's the virtual machine monitor in a privileged mode. So those instructions will be captured, and the virtual machine monitor can handle that. So that's the ideal model of trap emulation, or say the deprivileging, right? So another thing that we said that, right? If you want to virtualize a machine, a vulnerable machine, not only have the processor, but also have the virtual memory. So thinking about if we have the virtual memory, we need to support, right? What would happen? And thing is that if you are familiar with the hardware architecture, if you are familiar with the process of address translation, your applications, as we mentioned before, live in virtual address space. So all the memory addresses that your application issues are all virtual addresses. And most of the time, if you have a virtual address, right, that is not found, the translation is not found in the processor, well, then you have to contact a page table, right? And if you have to contact a page table, it's going to be really, really slow if every virtual address needs to go through that. So so now every processor, no matter what type of processor, usually would have a translation lookaside buffer, which caches some of the frequently used virtual address to physical address translation. So when your processor issued a virtual address, the TLB would give you the physical address. And in the meantime, you use the virtual address to look up your cache and produce a physical tag to see if there is a match, right? And if it's a match, you mean you know there is a hit. If it's a mismatch, you know this is a miss, right? And then finally, Only if the case that you cannot find an address translation, it will contact the page table. So that's the normal case, right? But now thinking about the fact that if we are having one more label in your system, that under your guest, under your operating system, there is something called virtual machine monitor. Then the scenario of address translation becomes really, really complicated in a way that, well, first of all, your application still issues virtual addresses. And then the operating system will translate the virtual address using a physical address that the guest operating system thought that's the physical address. However, if you are running on top of the virtual machine, the physical address is also another abstraction or an illusion created by the virtual machine. So in fact, this physical address has to be translated again in the virtual machine monitors its own page table. And that's the actual address, the machine on the machine, right? On a real machine, right? So the physical address is actually the physical address of the virtual machine monitor. And the machine address is the real physical address. So in virtual machine, if your application is running on top of a virtual machine, in fact, your address has to be translated for two times. The first time, getting the physical address that your operating system thought and the machine address that the virtual machine monitor really gives to the operating system, right? So you need a two-step translation. Now, the question here is that your processor remains unchanged. So the processor only have one TLB. So what the TLB should store, right? So if your TLB stores the physical address, then you still have to go through the virtual memory address, the address translation to produce the machine address. That's way inefficient. So to remedy this performance issue, right? Most virtual machine monitors would additionally create another thing called shadow page table. The shadow page table is a shortcut of a page table that when you are running an application on top of a guest operating system, it's a data structure that directly that caches some of the translation between the virtual address to machine addresses. So this is the virtual page table structure. So in this way, if your data can be your virtual address could be found in the shadow page table, you can directly have the machine address. Otherwise, you still have to go through this translation. So if you have this shadow page table structure, the TLB will cache the content in the shadow page structure page table structure because that gives you the virtual address to machine address translation. So this is called shadow data structure, right? So instead, in this architecture, both your cache and your TLB will be using the machine address instead of physical address for their target of translation, so that you can avoid the second level lookup here and improve the performance of your virtual machine applications. So the last idea is that the last idea of implementing a classical virtual machine is tracing. So although we say that we want to maintain a shadow page table structure, however, how can you make sure that the shadow page table is consistent with your operating system page table because it's changing all the time, right? So the idea is that, well, you have to make sure that this shadow page table structure and your guest operating system page table structure to be write protected, right? So so in this way, if anyone tries to modify the protected page table entry, it will trigger a segmentation fault. And you should know what is segmentation fault, right? And you know there's an mprotect function that would help you to protect a certain page to be read only, right? So if you are reading, you are fine. But if you are trying to modify it, it will generate a seg fault. And the seg fault handler, since the seg fault handler is going to be captured by the virtual machine monitor. So it will look at the source of seg fault. And if the address is a write protected page used for shadow page table, then the virtual machine monitor will know that, well, we should deal with this case separately from the normal protection in a way that it's a chance that we need to modify the shadow page table structure and the operating system page table structure so that we can make it consistent. So these are the three things that we use to implement the virtual machine monitor. So now the question is that, well, this idea seems pretty reasonable, but in fact, you read a paper regarding implementing the virtual machine monitor on S86. It says it doesn't work. So right now I want to ask you why it doesn't work. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, so now it looks like we definitely want to have some discussion. So go ahead and have a 2-minute discussion. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, so now I'm inviting one of the group to share your thoughts with us. Okay, so I have Xing'an.
Yes, our group choose C, two, and our opinion is that one and two are correct and three and four are incorrect.
Okay, so do you have any citation to support your answer?
We saw that on page 3, 3.1 section, and first, the visibility of privileged state. It says the guest can observe that it has been deprivileged when blah, blah, blah. So, so I think one is correct. And the second one, lack of traps when privileged instructions run at user level. So maybe the second one is correct.
Okay, right. So thanks for your insights, right? So in fact, you guys are getting it right in a way that, first of all, right, according to the paper, and unfortunately or fortunately, right, the x86 architecture is somewhat transparent in a way that, well, the application or the operating system itself can use the code segment selector to see what's my current privilege level, right? So the guest operating system will be aware that, well, I am not in a privilege level that I am supposed to be, right? So the operating system, so first of all, right, we remember there are three things, fidelity, performance, and safety and isolation. So according to this, right, the fidelity things cannot be maintained, right? Because your operating system already know, okay, it's not a real machine. I saw it, right? So that's actually an issue, right? And in fact, the operating system must check that I am in a preview mode to execute some operate, if the operating system really needs to make sure that it can function if it's in a privileged mode, then a lot of function may not be working. And the second thing is that, okay, even set the first statement aside, right? A privileged instruction may not trigger a trap if it's not in the appropriate privilege mode. So saying that, well, if my operating system right now is running in a reduced privilege mode, not the true privilege mode, what would happen is that some instruction like popf, right, may change its behavior, right? So if it's deprivileged, right, the popf will behave like user mode popf that just surpass the attempt to modify the if. So it's not going to trigger any kind of trap, and it becomes a user mode application, right? So, instruction. So you are not going to get the same outcome as running even though the same instruction in privilege mode. So that's not working, right? Because both would violate the fidelity statement that we want about a virtual machine. And that's, and set aside from performance, right? Performance, if we say that, well, it's okay, performance, we know it's going to be slow anyway, right? Even though that performance is not an issue, the fidelity is more of an issue because your machine is going to behave differently than a real machine, right? So that's why we definitely don't want this to happen. So let's see how VMware tackled these difficulties on an x86 processor. So this is a paper from VMware. And if you want to know how VMware implement their virtual machine, this is definitely the paper you want to look into. So the idea that behind the VMware software is this binary translator. So so the binary translator, the translation on x86 is this, right? If the the virtualized processor is in user mode again, right? So if it's in user mode, there's no issue. We don't have any issue with that, because even though with the virtual machine monitor, those instructions would directly execute on the bare machine. What would really be problematic is that, right, if your guest operating system is supposed to be in a kernel mode, so for example, saying that you have a system call, right, the virtual machine monitor should know how to deal with that correctly. And if part of the kernel mode instruction, like popf, has the dual mode situation that if you are running in a deep privileged mode, then the code won't be, is giving you the same outcome, then you have to translate those instructions into different sets of instruction. So what happened in VMware is that the virtual machine monitor would exempt. So whenever there is a system call, right? So remember the graph that we have, right? Whenever you have a system call, first of all, you go to the VMM. Right. So, in the original deep privileged model, after handling some status, you are going back to the operating system, right? But what the VMware is doing is that we know that some of the instruction here may be problematic if you run it as what it is, what it used to be, right? So what the VMware binary translator would do is that, okay, I know you are going to run this handler. So what I'm going to do is that I am going to go ahead and look at the handler. If there is any instruction like popf inside, then I would translate those instructions into equivalent instructions with those flags set appropriately. So the popf would be modified as another sequence of instructions that would have the IF flag set instead of the original popf. So that's the whole idea of binary translation. So you can imagine the overhead here not only has the overhead of modifying the virtual CPU status, but also you have to go ahead and prefetch and read instructions and translate those instructions dynamically, right? So that's the overhead of virtual machine monitor on SAD6 processor. So with binary translation, what would happen is this, right? So if it's normal instruction, go ahead and execute it. If it's a system call, because it's a system call, so you are still able to go into the privileged mode in a virtual machine monitor. And when handling and updating the vCPU status, we know that the guest operating system has will be trapped into a handler. However, when we when we execute this handler, we will go ahead and see if there is any spatial privilege instruction. If there is privilege instruction that are spatial, then the virtual machine monitor will rewrite those instructions and execute using the virtual machine monitor's modified code in the right privilege mode to have the handler getting the right feature function as what it's supposed to be. So that's the trick and emulation with binary translation. So that's something different from the original trap and emulate. That's one thing, right? And as we mentioned, right, this is really slow, right? Because you need the virtual machine translation. And another thing is that every time, right, when you have to do this kind of chef emulation, the overhead always have to be is that you have to handle and update the virtual CPU status, right? So that's really, really slow, right? If you do this in pure instruction set to emulate this operation. So modern SAD6 processor provide another hardware support called hardware virtualization. So the basic idea of the hardware virtualization is that we know that each machine, virtual machine, would have a control block. The control block includes the information regarding the emulated virtual memory system and emulated processor, like those vCPU. Right, so instead of having the virtual machine monitor using a sequence of instructions to deal with that, the hardware virtualization just provide a single instruction for the virtual machine to say, well, as long as you are okay to follow our convention or protocol to design your virtual machine control block, and we can use a single instruction to help you modify and update those field in the virtual machine control block. So, and we are going to provide a new privilege execution mode called guest mode for your virtual machine to run on it. So what would happen is that, well, in the past, right, when you handle this update of vCPU status, you have to use many, many instructions. Right now, it's just a VM run instruction plus a VM run instruction plus the virtual machine control block that you want to modify. And the virtual machine this instruction will help you modify this and set your instruction to be in a VMX mode. So when you are in a VMX mode, right, some of the binary translated instruction, well, we know it's in VMX mode. So the x86 processor will handle those correctly because we know, well, in this mode, they are supposed to be running with the as the privileged mode. And the only thing that you have to be aware is that, well, when I am running, like for example, the POPF, right? Instead of modifying the processor states, I should update the BMCB as well. And this is all done by the hardware instruction provided by x86. So you don't have to use a set of instructions to emulate the behavior of that. So this is the whole, so this is why if you run VMware on x86 processor today, it becomes a lot faster. And if you don't believe that, right, go to your BIOS and turn off the hardware virtualization support, then you will definitely feel some difference. So this is the hardware support provided by so this is how it works, right? So first of all, the virtual machine will fill the VMCB exception table for the guest operating system and set bits in the virtual machine control block to not exit on the system call exception. And your virtual machine monitor, whenever you have a system call, we just execute the VMRun instruction and it will change the BMCV exception instead of the real CPU, right? So that's the whole idea. So this paper also provides you some insights that, well, there are cases that you definitely don't want to use VMCB, right? So VMRun instruction. So can you identify those cases in a paper that we assign you to read? All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay. So now I am going to have you guys go into group discussion. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so now I am inviting one of the group to share your thoughts with us. Okay, so I have a Rogelio. What do you think?
Well, I'm gonna go with, okay, I think the answer is C. One and two are correct. Okay. I definitely know one is correct because in the paper, I believe it's page eight or, okay, I can't remember what pages it was on, but I know that in software virtual machine support, system calls have to go through the VMM requiring 2,000 more cycles, apparently. And then in hardware support, system calls, there's no VMM intervention. So
okay, so what's the other case?
For handling page faults,
so what the other group is thinking about that? Okay, so I have Andrew.
I think the answer is 1 and 4, system call and calling the function.
Mm-hmm.
But looking
how
at the,
did you find?
Looking at the figure 4 and 5, the benchmark and the overhead, we can see that.
So actually the answer of this one is pretty easy to find, right? Like you see that, well, when you have like system call, then this is the latency for a software VMM and this is the hardware VMM. It's like nothing, right? So which one will show you the, and for page fault, right? It's actually, you see the hardware VMM, you can see the black here, but you cannot see the software here, right? So page fault is definitely not the case, right?
Right.
But and as Andrew said, right, for function calls, right? So for function calls that like this one, the call return, right? The hardware VMM actually shows the performance is almost the same as native, running on the native machine, right? If you have the hardware VMM. And this give you another view that for the page fault is going to be more, right? Okay, so I think for this question, I would give Team Blue a point, right? So right now, I think you guys are 23 versus 22 from the score that I aggregated so far. So Team Blue, you got a chance to fight back now. So hopefully, and we have two more questions left. So you guys really have a chance, right? Okay, so for this one, right, well, you can answer this question easily from looking at the result graph, right? But what's the rationale behind that is that, well, if you execute system calls as the guest operating system, because for original software based virtual machine monitor, without the S86 instruction support, you need a guest operating system run in VM mode. And whenever you have a system call, your virtual machine monitor have to update the vCPU status using those instruction sequence. However, with hardware support, as I said, all you need is a VM run instruction and give the VMCB and you are done, right? However, for handling page fault, the original soft VMM doesn't really need to use VM run and exit already, right? So if you force the virtual machine monitor to use VM run and an exit, it's actually adding some more overhead because you have to run the virtual machine control block. However, the original software VMM, all it does is that we intercept this write protection and directly modifying the page table. Right. So again, as modifying the page table entry, there's no difference between the instruction sequence that you have to use in a software VMM and a hardware VMM. And in fact, for the hardware VMM, you have the overhead of VM run and exit. However, when you're calling a function, right, the hardware VMM, it doesn't need to backtrace on things. So when calling a function, the hardware VMM the hardware VMM doesn't need to binary translation when you are calling a function, because some of the function code indeed needs some translation in handling those pop and push differently. However, if you have hardware VMM, you don't have to handle that differently. So that's why 1 and 4 they are correct. Right. So here is the side-by-side comparison between the hardware VMM and the binary translation VMM. So before the S86 processor supports the hardware instructions, the pure binary translation based VMM, you always have to convert traps into callouts, which means that these callouts are are those instructions used in the instruction in the VMM? And you also So whenever you have a trap, right, it's just directly go to your VMM. So you don't have to specifically call. So this is the thing, right? So for hardware for binary translation based VMM, whenever you have a system call, you directly go trap into the VMM. However, for the hardware-based VMM, what happened is that you will have to execute VM run and exit before and after your system call. So that's also another overhead. However, you don't have to suffer this overhead in binary translation if the handler itself doesn't contain any spatial instruction. However, if your handler has spatialized instruction, then our VMM is going to give you better performance in function calls, right? And also, if you want to handle those exceptions precisely, the hardware VMM, because the hardware does that for you, so it's more precise. However, in software, a binary translation, you have to emulate those instruction sequences, right? So and also the code density is also better. The code density means that the size of your code, because in binary translation, one instruction may be translated into multiple instructions. So the amount of instruction that you will have to execute is definitely going to be more than that, more than the original instruction. So hardware VMM has those benefits. However, right, for the binary translation, when you are emulating, because you don't have to maintain the BNCB externally using the VM run and exit instruction, so it's definitely faster in this way. So those are the benefits and the drawback of each side. So now you know, like, if you want to design a perfect VMM, right? There are cases that you definitely want the hardware to help. So for example, system calls, function calls. However, when you are maintaining your page table, you don't want the hardware instruction to help you, right? So that's how you implement an efficient S86 virtual machine monitor. So now I'm going to talk about another type of virtual machine implementation. And this paper is called Zen and the Art of Virtualization. So why Zen and the Art of Virtualization is actually because the author is a big fan of motorcycle. So they actually have a Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance book. And the name is inspired by this book. But the real why behind the Zen hypervisor is that, well, we want to improve the server utilization. And we want to have multiple servers running to get all together on the same machine, right? And we also want the machine to be safely and isolated. However, if you don't, and as we can see from the experience from VMware, is that they have to use binary translation, or they have to use spatial hardware instructions, and both of them would add overhead when you are executing software on the bare machine. So that's the virtual machine. So that's not really good, right? So the idea of Zen is that we want to avoid this whole overhead to host as many full operating system instances as possible, right? So how they did it? So they proposed an idea called paravirtualization against the full virtualization. So this question is asking you about what's the difference between paravirtualization and full virtualization? All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so looks like we definitely need some discussion. Go ahead, do it. Let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so now I am inviting one of the team to share your thoughts with us. So let me see who is faster. Okay, Rogelio, what does your group think?
Group thinks that three are correct.
Okay, what are the three?
One, three, and four.
One, three, and four. Okay, how about we Team Blue? What do you guys think? Can I have a representative from Team Blue? Hello, somebody there? Okay, so Tyler, what does your group think?
So we were talking over when it ended, but we tentatively are going with one and three.
One and three.
Yeah.
Okay. So unfortunately, I would say both of the team didn't get the correct answer. So let me tell you what really is here. All right, so So what's paravirtualization? So first of all, paravirtualization is, okay, let me look at this. So the concept of paravirtualization is that, right? We said that because x86, they have the issue of some spatial instructions. So you have to use binary translator to dynamically translate those instructions. So the the basic idea of paravirtualization is that, okay, so now instead of, and one of the issues is because we don't want to modify our operating system handler code so that you are using exactly the same instruction sequence as in a deprivileged mode. However, the paravirtualization just abandoned that idea. Okay, we don't want to present a fidelity over the operating system level, but we just want to preserve the fidelity of the application level. So application doesn't need to be changed. What really have to be changed is the guest operating system that the guest operating system would make a hyper call instead of a system call to interact with the system resource. And when they are using this hyper calls, the handler will have different writings than the original system call handler. So, and in this way, right, because you already modify your handlers, so those handlers, they won't be using these instructions that needs to be binary translated. So in this way, right, when you have those exceptions, right, and those hypercalls, when the Xen hypervisor receive those exceptions, they just directly trust those hypercall handlers and just use them directly without any binary translation, without modifying the virtual processor states, right? So the whole idea of paravirtualization is that, okay, we abandoned the idea that we just gave up that operating system doesn't need to be modified, but they're still sticky with the fact that the software itself doesn't need to be modified. So what really happened is that your software still issued the system calls. Your software should still issue the system calls. However, the handler inside of your what will happen is that on previous instruction still goes as what it is. The application issues system calls. However, this system calls would be jump into the trap handler in the modified guest operating system using those hyper call handlers. And those instructions, they don't have to be, and there is no binary translated instruction used in those hyper call handlers. So the application itself doesn't need to be modified. However, all need to be modified is the guest operating system. So that's the idea of paravirtualization. So for the paravirtualization, right, what really needs to be modified is the guest operating system, however, not the applications. And because you modify the guest operating system, so it doesn't need the binary translation. And because you don't have the binary translation, you don't have to wait the binary translation to translate the code. So for time sensitive tasks, it has better support. And because you are modifying your guest operating system anyway, why don't you just modify your guest operating system to manage the physical to machine address mapping directly? Meaning that your guest operating system would maintain the shadow, the page table structure to directly translate the virtual address to machine address. So three of them are correct. And the answer is 2, 3, and 4. And application doesn't need to be modified. So this is the architecture of the Xen hypervisor. So your modified operating system will be running in a reduced privilege mode. And the Xen hypervisor would have a paravirtualized CPU, paravirtualized memory, paravirtualized storage, paravirtualized network, and paravirtualized everything, right? And the basic idea of paravirtualization is that your guest operating system is using hypercalls that requests resource from the hypervisor, and the handler is returned in a way that you don't need binary translated instructions. So that's the basic concept of virtualization, is that we just modify our operating system directly, right? So now an issue that we mentioned is that, well, with paravirtualization, you don't need to maintain a separate shadow page table structure, but how that idea really works. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, so now let's go ahead and have a quick group discussion. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so now I'm inviting one of the group to share your thoughts with us. Okay, so I have Tyler. What do you guys think?
Our group went with D3 and the ones that we...
Okay, parsed, what are the three?
One, two, and four. Three we okay. know is incorrect because on page two, I think, it says mm-hmm. that full virtualization requires shadow page tables, but Xen need only be involved in page table updates, which is also...
Mm-hmm. Means so that it also tells you that two is true, right?
Yeah. Switching guest about OSs will trigger a TLB flush. That's on page, I think, oh, I just lost it. I think it was on page four.
Okay. And how about fourth?
Can directly access the page table in a guest OS of Xen. I don't have a page for where that is. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't.
But the thing is that if you don't rely on a shadow page table, right, you don't actually, it also implies this one, right? Okay, so, and I think Team Blue got it, right? This question is actually like three of them are correct. And the reason why whenever you're switching guest operating system will trigger a TLB flush is that because in S86 architecture, the TLBs are not tagged. It means that we cannot distinguish if the virtual address belongs to this process or another process. And again, because your operating system is running in a deprivileged mode, you should imagine that your virtual machine monitor act like the real operating system. And the guest operating system is like a process in the virtual machine monitor. So when you switching guest operating system is like context switching. So you have to flush the TLB as well, right? So so in that case, definitely would trigger a TLB mess, right? And use hypercall to validate the every page table update, right? Because and another reason why we need to do that because it's still the virtual machine monitor allocating the machine address for the guest operating system. So you don't have to create a shadow page table. However, your guest operating system will involve in the process of updating the page table to map your virtual address to a machine address that Xen hypervisor provided to the guest operating system. Right, so your guest operating system doesn't live on the full virtual address space provided by the virtual machine monitor. Instead, you already assume that there is another one who is going to give you the real machine address for you, and that's the Xen hypervisor. So you don't need a two-level structure, and because you have just one single page table, so it's implies that the S86 processor would be able to directly access, right? So in this way, whenever you have a page fault, it will be a lot faster. And because this, so however, this is still an overhead that you cannot avoid, right? So so for Xen hypervisor, whenever you have a TLB miss, right, then the processor MMU walk through the page table to update the content. And whenever you are accessing, if there is a page fault, meaning that the translation is not even there, then the Xen hypervisor would give the guest operating system a physical page, and then the guest operating system would be able to use that physical page or say the machine page as the new mapping between the virtual and physical address. So that's the whole idea of Xen hypervisor. But doing all of this require a lot of code modification. And another thing that I think is really interesting in the Xen hypervisor is that they have a balloon driver. So in Zen Hypervisor, they install a balloon driver inside each of the guest operating system. So the balloon driver is actually like a spy in each software, in each guest operating system that it will dynamically expand itself if it finds out that the memory consumption of the guest operating system is not really that large. So and when the balloon driver expand itself, it will use the expanded memory capacity of that balloon itself and steal those page to another guest operating system so that some other guest operating system can actually steal the memory pages from one operating system to another. So that's a very interesting design. And without modifying the guest operating system call, it's impossible to have the balloon driver installed in an operating system. So that's a very, very interesting design. And there are also other things like IO virtualization, how they virtualize the IO devices, network devices. Those are interesting for you to read. And here is the performance of Zen Hypervisor. As you can see, the native Linux is the L bar, and the Zen Hypervisor is actually this, right? And the VMware workstation is their competitor, is this. So you can see the Zen Hypervisor is very, very close to the performance of the native Linux. However, there is a long way to go between VMware workstation. So they claim that the percentage of the S86 code they have to modify in Linux is only about 1.36%, and for Windows XP is only this amount, right? So what they propose is that for those cloud service provider, all they want is performance. All they want is to reduce the cost of machine, right? So they are willing to pay this overhead by hiring more software engineer like you guys, right? Like Amazon hire a lot of you guys to modify the operating system. So it's kind of interesting, right? Every time when you launch a virtual machine instance on Amazon, you are not allowed to use the original Ubuntu image. You always have to use their own because they are using a system like Zen Hypervisor inside their data centers. And in the data centers is a relatively well-controlled environment that they can force their users to use their images. So it's fine for them to use that. But for a general user, if you don't have the capability to modify the operating system yourself, then you definitely want to feed, it definitely an overhead for the common user to deal with that, right? So there are new evolution of Zen, but one thing I want to tell you is that the concept of Zen is actually the most popular in data center. So that's why Zen this paper is really important. Okay, so we still have a few minutes left. So now I'm going to talk about this paper as a reflection of the whole quarter. This is by Butler Lamberson. He is originally in Xerox Palo Alto Research Center and now in Microsoft. And so for this paper, it talks about a lot of things about computer system design. And I feel this is a really good paper to talk about, right? So they talk about a lot of why, where, and function speed. Is it fast enough, right? So there are a few things that you can use that paper as a reflection. So one of the things that they mentioned in a paper is that separate normal and worst case. And throughout this quarter, you have read a lot of cloud storage. Can you tell me what are the papers that you read, they try to separate the normal and the worst case? All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, so quick group discussion. Let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so sudden death. Which group will I like to share with us? Last question of the quarter. And it's now 23 versus 23. Any group? So quiet. Any group would like to share your thoughts with us? Hello? All right, Emmanuel, what do you guys think?
We weren't able to finish our discussion. From what I could find in the other papers, Facebook and the Google file system talked about a near worst case scenario.
But are they trying to separate normal and worst case? Okay, so Xingyun, what do you think?
My answer is B. I think the Facebook is right.
Okay, so how can you tell?
The normal case of F4 is hard data, the frequently request the data, and the worst case is the old data. They are not most frequently to be requested.
So for other file system, do they have this separation?
I'm not sure, so I don't choose them.
Okay, all right. So the answer is that only one of them is correct, because F4 actually separate the hot gold data, and hot data is, and they separate the normal case and the worst case scenario so that their design can be more efficient, right? So here's the thing, right? So for system design, there are a lot of things that you have to think about. Make common case fast, and the worst case must make progress, like hot cold data must make progress, saturation must make progress, thrashing must make progress, right? So that's why these papers, they are, but if you look at other papers like Google's file system, right? If it's a worst case, they don't deal with it, right? For Windows Azure, it's all about the worst case scenario, right? For NFS, they also don't deal with the worst case, right? So that's why only Facebook work is considering the fact. And there are other things that you probably already heard, like the KISS design philosophy, that you have to keep your interface simple and stupid. And more things on interface and implementation side, there are a lot of good ideas, like if you want to have your performance better, right, use static analysis instead of like Zen Hypervisor versus VMware, right? So dynamic translation is also a good idea, but it's only good if in terms of the perspective, but not from the performance perspective, right? And cache is also the good idea. Use hints to speed up normal execution, and there are a lot of different things that you definitely have to check, right? Okay, so now, and for fault tolerance, right, you also learned that like log are good ideas and atomic operations so that your operation can always be restartable also simplifies your system design. All right, so now before I talk about a final exam, I do want to invite all of you to show your face on the camera, and then I'm going to take a very, very quick a group photo together. So why don't you turn on your camera right now, and let's do it. So let's do the group photo together, and so that I have an idea, right? And the reason why I want to do this is also because sometimes you guys want me to write a letter for you, and if I never saw you, then I would have trouble like writing those letters. So definitely is a good idea to show your face in front of me. All right, so now I am going to take the photo if possible. That's keep your smile, keep smiling. I'm taking a few photos. I'm taking another one right now. I'm taking one right now, another one right now. Okay, I think we are good. All right, and now let's talk about final exam. Sorry for taking you more minutes out of it, but I do know that you care about this. So again, the final exam is a different format. We have part one and part two. And part one, I would have you starting from a few minutes later, like 8 p.m. today. And the reason why is because they are all open-ended questions. So I want you to spend more time thinking about it. So it's time unlimited. So you can actually open it a few minutes later and see what kind of question that I'm asking. And you are going to read a few more papers when you want to deal with those questions. So it's definitely a very interesting experience. And part two is very similar to a midterm, and it's actually having fewer questions than your midterm. So, oh, it's any 18 minutes instead of hours. Sorry, 18 minutes, not hours. 80 hours, too much, right? 18 minutes, any consecutive 18 minutes that you pick. And two of the questions are considered as comprehensive exam. And so part one consists of brainstorming questions, and there is no standard answers. So I will be very surprised that if I saw two of you have the same answer. And if I saw those cases, I would definitely that the school decides if it's a cheating case, right? So definitely do this by yourself, because I do expect that each one should have a different answer on part one. And for part two, we have free answer questions, and those two free answer questions, one about processes and the other about virtual memory, they would be counted as comprehensive exam questions. And even though you are not taking this as a comprehensive exam, you still have to finish those questions. Multiple choice, we only have 10. And it's very like your the question in your midterm. And we also have multiple answer questions. So what it looks like, right? So in operating system design, we care performance a lot. So latency numbers, very important. And based on the latency numbers, the free answer question, pretty much similar to your midterm, we will ask you about, well, can you estimate the latency of TLB missed, page fault, context switch, or kernel switch, right? And under what condition would you imagine that a saturation or stretching to occur? Right, so those are the things you have to use the number table to justify your answer. And also there are multiple choice questions as what you have in the midterm, right? And another question that you didn't interact before is the multiple answer question. So you have read 20 papers in this quarter. So I do want you to go through this paper again and tell me if I am designing for example, right? If I'm designing a read intensive file system, write intensive data file system, MapReduce used data system, right? And what papers talk about saturation, threshing, right? And combine the hints of convolution system, who use caching, who use batch, who use atomic operations, who use logs, and who separate the normal and worst case, like the last question that I asked you guys about, right? So those are the things that you might be expecting in your multiple answer sections, right? So we have iEval due, and if you want to boost up your reading quiz grades, that's a good chance for you to do. And project revision due tonight is the last chance for you to get better grades for your project. And don't forget to check your grades on iLearn, and including the iEval, we will drop a total of your lowest reading quizzes. However, don't forget that four of the reading quizzes are actually coming from your attendance. So those are the things that the very, very last thing that I want to let you guys know before taking your midterm. And sorry for taking 10 more minutes. It's really great to have you guys throughout this quarter. Although I cannot meet you in person, but definitely this is one of the best ever operating system class that I taught before. And the success of this class cannot be achieved without you. So thank you all for this great quarter, and enjoy the rest of your quarter, the rest of your time, and hopefully we can see each other in person.
Watch the curtains wide open, and you fall in the same routine.